This is the motto of the show, Hour of the Truth. Rome never changes. They used to call us heretics and sent the Inquisition to kill us. Today they call us terrorists and send on their crusades. Times and methods may have changed, but the goal still stays the same. Extirpate the remnant of the true Word of God, Bible-believing people who uphold the truths of Jesus Christ's name.
From 1203 to 1805, 50 million Christians died. Suffering at the hands of Rome, 'cause they believed in Christ alone. They died through Europe, especially Spain, for they saw all but Christ is vain. He suffered by his death for men, to save them from their awful sin. 600 years of martyred saints that history cannot erase. With iron heel and iron hand, the Roman popes rule the land. Those ignorant of history may be swept into apostasy. We won't be lulled by Rome's sweet lie, with 50 million reasons why. Salvation is by faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. A sovereign God give faith to man. Salvation's in the Maker's hand. This gospel offends Rome today. They offer up another way, a counterfeit, a compromise. Beware the ancient papal lie, with such a cloud of witnesses who by grace died in their Lord. Recall their memory to say, by the same faith we live today.
Good evening. My name's Tom Press, and I'm host of Inquisition Update on FirstAmendmentRadio.com. And for the last few weeks, I've been reading and discussing a book entitled Romanism and the Reformation from the Standpoint of Prophecy. It was a book written by a great Protestant, a pastor, a teacher, a reformer, a prophecy student, an orator and lecturer and evangelist, Henry Grattan Guinness. This book, by popular demand, is being made the subject of this broadcast, and it's not only my pleasure, but it's my blessing to get to read this book again and to get to lead a discussion about the book. The program tonight is planned to be 2 hours in length. The first hour will be spent reading the book. The second hour, hopefully, in a fruitful discussion about the book. I will begin by reading the foreword of the book, but before I even begin reading the book, I want to impress upon the listeners that this book was written in the late 1800s when Protestantism was under attack in England. It was under attack from without and from within. And Henry Grattan Guinness took it upon himself to write a series of lectures warning England about the threat that was posed in England against the Protestant Reformation. Those threats, as relevant as they were for his day, are even more relevant to us in this day, and particularly here in the United States of America. Henry Grattan Guinness's mission was to warn Protestants that Rome was making progress, inroads, in an attempt to overthrow Protestantism in Great Britain. Great Britain, historically, was a Protestant country, but it battled continually to maintain its Protestant beliefs because of assaults from the Roman Catholic Church. So England opposed the Roman Catholic Church in the form of wars, and the papacy launched retaliatory strikes against England to make England Catholic, even to the attempt to blow up Parliament in 1605 with the gunpowder plot. The Spanish Armada was levied by the papacy against England to forcibly overthrow its Protestant government. The Babington plot and many other attempts to make England Catholic. This country has never opposed Rome, not in the sense that England did. And Roman Catholicism has enjoyed religious liberty in this country. Her Jesuits, her militia, have enjoyed unfettered, unrestrained operations in the United States of America. So if Rome worked so hard to overthrow Protestantism in England, which retaliated in opposition to Rome, what advantages has Rome gained in this country by such an agreeable nation as the United States of America? My hope is that as I read and discuss this book, your eyes will be opened and you will come to realize that the New World Order spoken of today is simply the old world order restored, not just in the United States of America, where the old world order was never known, but globally. Now, I'll begin with the introduction to this program, or the preface to the book. Just remember, as I read, consider as I read about the history of England in these lectures by Henry Grattan Guinness, what the situation bodes for here in the United States of America today. Now, the preface begins. The following lectures were delivered by request under the auspices of the Protestant Educational Institute at Exeter Hall in the spring of this year. That institute exists to do a much-needed work to keep alive, especially in the hearts of the rising generation, some measure of intelligent sympathy with the Protestant traditions of our country. Now, I'll comment at this point, even as early as it is. This educational institute at Exeter Hall is in England. And this institute was established to maintain Protestantism in England. And their attempt was to just maintain some measure of the sympathy with the Protestant traditions of their country. Clearly, even by the language used by the author, at this point we can see that England was in a desperate situation vis-a-vis Protestantism. They were desperately trying to maintain some intelligent sympathy in England for the Protestant traditions of their country. Rome had already made tremendous inroads in England to restore Vatican control in England. And this book is written in order to wake up England to the reality of the Roman domination in England and how it had perverted Protestantism. Listen carefully as he continues. England's Protestantism has long been England's glory and the direct cause of her unrivaled prosperity and particular preeminence among the nations of Europe. That Protestantism is now sustaining a double attack from without and from within. Yet few seem fully alive to the danger. The late Lord Beaconsfield saw it clearly enough, however, quote, "Your empire and your liberties are more in danger at this moment," he said, than when Napoleon's army of observation was encamped at Boulogne, unquote. What would he have said had he lived to see the present position of affairs? The Reformation of the 16th century, which gave birth to Protestantism, was based on Scripture. It gave back to the world the Bible. It taught the Scriptures. It exposed the errors and corruptions of Rome by the use of the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. It applied the prophecies and accepted their practical guidance. Such Reformation work requires to be done afresh. We have suffered prophetic anti-papal truth to be too much forgotten. This generation is dangerously latitudinarian, indifferent to truth and error on points on which Scripture is tremendously decided and absolutely clear. These lectures, simple and popular as they are, will, it is hoped, open many minds to perceive that the Bible gives no uncertain sound as to Romanism, and that those who will be guided by its teachings must shun an apostasy against which the sorest judgments are denounced. The lectures are given as delivered, with exception of the first and the last, which have been extended and modified. In recasting and enlarging the opening lecture on the Daniel foreview and the closing one on the Reformation, I have availed myself of the valuable help of my beloved wife, who has for so many years been my fellow laborer both in literary and evangelistic work. I shall rejoice if these lectures obtain a wide circulation, for they contain, I am sure, truth for the times, truth deeply and increasingly needed, not only for the preservation of the civil and religious liberties of our country and empire, but for the practical guidance of the people of God in these last days. Signed, Henry Grattan Guinness, June 1st, 1887. Now we'll begin with the very first lecture in the book, page one of the text. It's entitled The Daniel Foreview of Romanism. This author, Henry Grattan Guinness, is going to tell us from the words of the prophet Daniel about this Roman beast, that Daniel foresaw the rise of the Roman Catholic Church and the papacy. He was speaking of none else but the Roman Catholic Church and the papacy in his prophecies. These are facts that are hardly even mentioned in the churches today. That's why the churches are apostate. That's why the churches look for a future Antichrist when he's been with us all along. Now, what did Daniel have to say? Henry Grattan Guinness begins by saying, 50 years ago, the eminent statesman Sir Robert Peel said, with remarkably clear foresight, quote, "The day is not distant and may be very near when we shall have to fight the battle of the Reformation over again," unquote. That day has come. It has been upon us for some time. It has found us unprepared. And as a result, the battle has to some extent been going against us. More than three centuries of emancipation from the yoke of Rome, 300 years of Bible light and liberty, had made us overconfident and led us to underestimate the power and influence of the deadliest foe, not only of the gospel of God, but also of Protestant England. Britain's honorable distinction of being the leading witness among the nations for the truth of the gospel and against the errors of Romanism had come to be lightly esteemed among us. Our fathers won this distinction through years of sore struggle and strife. They purchased it with their best blood and prized it as men prize that which cost them dear. It had cost us nothing. We were born to it. We knew not its value by contrast as they did. In the early part of this century, the power of Rome was in these lands a thing of the past, and it seemed to be fast decaying, even in other lands. The notion grew up among us that there was no need to fear any revival of that deadly upas tree, which is the blight of all that is great and good, pure and prosperous. The light of true knowledge had forever dispelled the dark fogs of superstition, so it was supposed. Medieval tyrannies and cruelties cloaked under a pretense of religion could never again obtain a foothold in these lands of light and liberty. We might despise and deride the corruptions and follies of Rome, but as to dreading her influence, no. She was too far gone and too feeble to inspire fear or even watchfulness. Now, I would like to make a quote, or a comment, rather. What Henry Grattan Guinness is telling us is that prior to the writing of this book, prior to the end of the 1700s, first, there was the Protestant Reformation in 1517 AD, led by Martin Luther on October 31st, 1517, that literally liberated all of Europe, that was tyrannized and under the yoke and the iron boot of Rome. Rome, the papacy in particular, called himself the Vicar of Christ, the replacement of the Son of God on earth, and declared by divine right that he should rule every man, woman, and child on the planet. And the way he implemented that decree was that he picked all the kings of Europe. And in order for them to maintain their imperial crowns, they had to serve the papacy and do what he said. And through them, the papacy ruled every man, woman, and child in Europe. And during that period of time, prior to the Protestant Reformation, the people were held in ignorance. The only ones who had education were the quote-unquote rich ruling elite, that is, the priests of Rome, and their landholders. The people were held in ignorance and superstition. They were forced to be Roman Catholics. If they swore against Roman Catholicism or the papacy or the king of their country, they were hauled off to the Inquisition to be persecuted and slain. It was a capital punishment to levy any criticism against the king, who was selected by the Pope by divine right to rule, to criticize the church, or to criticize the Pope. And the people were not allowed to read the Bible. And as a matter of fact, the church services were even held in Latin, and the people couldn't even understand what was going on in church. So a combination of these and other things, Rome was in darkness. Europe was in darkness. Papal darkness and tyranny. Whatever the Pope said, whatever the king said was law. All dissension was put down by blood. Now, because of the Protestant Reformation, because of the fact that the Protestant Reformation enabled the scriptures to be translated into all the languages of the people, and the people being taught how to read, they realized that the scripture, and particularly as we're talking about now in this book, Daniel's prophecies, clearly identified the papacy as the man of sin, the little horn of Daniel, the one who had become recognized as the Antichrist in the world. and they recognized their church, the Roman Catholic Church, to be the synagogue of Satan, the papacy to be the Antichrist, and they came out of the Roman Catholic Church in droves, and the papacy lost its control of the people. And because the Bible spread like wildfire, people began to read these things for themselves and realize that God no longer dwells in temples made with hands, such as St. Peter's in Rome, and that God wrote his law upon their hearts. They had no need for tyranny. So they overthrew their papal monarchs, they overthrew the Pope, and they put Christ on the throne of their hearts and lives. And this alone liberated all of Europe and nearly destroyed the papacy. The whole world was aware that the papacy was the man of sin, the son of perdition, the Antichrist of the Bible, the little horn of Daniel. And even the kings of the earth who used to kowtow to the papacy realized that they, in order to keep their crowns, better serve the people than the Pope. So they too abandoned the papacy. Now, Protestantism did its effectual work. When the truth of the light of the gospel and the light of Jesus Christ comes into the world, the darkness is plainly exposed. But that wasn't the only problem that the papacy and the Roman Catholic Church suffered. In the late 1700s, there were the Napoleonic Wars. The revolution known as the French Revolution took place. And it, unlike the Protestant Revolution, was a godless revolution. It saw everything religious as a hindrance. And excepting for the fact that it was simply a cloak to cover up Napoleon's punishment. See, Napoleon was a 33rd degree Freemason, and he was under the control of the Jesuit order, who had recently been suppressed in 1773. Napoleon was set about by the Jesuits to punish all the kings of Europe for abandoning the papacy and for upholding the bull of suppression and extinction by Pope Clement XIV, suppressing the Jesuits. So a twofold attack Rome was under. The Protestant Reformation simply caused people to abandon the Roman Catholic Church. The French Revolution punished the papacy and the Roman Catholic Church. And for all intents and purposes, it appeared that Romanism was a thing of the past, that the papacy was stripped both of his spiritual and his temporal power. Europe had been liberated by the Protestant Reformation and by the Napoleonic Wars, and England, as a result, went to sleep. No longer did she fear Rome trying to make England Catholic again. The Protestants went to sleep, but the facts of history reveal that Rome was not destroyed. She appeared to be dead for all intents and purposes, but she was quite alive and made inroads into England even after she was thought to be dead. Now I'll continue. He says this was all a delusion, and we have been roughly undeceived. In other words, rudely awakened. Rome is not dead, is what he's saying. He says the difficult and dangerous crisis through which England is now passing is the direct result of the course of action taken under this delusion. And God only knows what the ultimate consequences may be. A serpent may be scotched, yet not killed. It may retain life enough to turn and inflict on its foe a fatal wound. The ground may be purged from a destructive weed, but the little remnants left behind may sprout and spread so as speedily to pervade the plot anew. It has been thus with Romish influence in Protestant England. Let the facts speak. 50 years ago, there were not 500 Roman Catholic priests in Great Britain. Now there are 2,600. 50 years ago, there were not but 500 chapels. Now there are 1,575. 50 years ago, there were no monasteries at all in Britain. Now there are 225. There were even then 16 convents, but now there are over 400 of these barred and bolted and impenetrable prisons in which 15,000 English women are kept prisoners at the mercy of a celibate clergy who have power, unless their behests are obeyed, to inflict on these hapless and helpless victims torture under the name of penance. And if you're carefully listening, I shouldn't have to tell you what that torture was. Cloistered nuns, all of them virgins, kept in prison by celibate priests. You can know in your heart what that torture was. He continues, 50 years ago, there were but two colleges in our land for the training of Roman Catholic priests, of men bound by oath to act in England as the agents of a foreign power, the one great object of which is about to be the dismemberment of our empire and the ruination of our influence in the world. Now there are 29 such schools. And I want to emphasize the importance here, making a comment. I want to emphasize the importance of the educational institutions of the Roman Catholic Church within any land, not just England. These institutions of higher learning, these colleges and universities, particularly those run by the Jesuit order, are designed to raise up men and women who will swear an oath to act for a foreign potentate, the Pope, against the legitimate governments of every land in this world. The United States has over 300 Roman Catholic institutions of education, 28 of the most powerful Jesuit universities in this country. And the graduates of those Jesuit universities are jobbed off into the highest political offices in our land. Their first loyalty is to the Pope. Their second loyalty, or possibly even third, is to this land. And when the Pope decides to destroy Protestantism in this land, these people who have been educated in these Jesuit universities will obey the Pope by a religious fervor. Now, we may make that assumption for this country, but England has lived through this over and over and over because of the Roman Catholic institutions in England. Over and over and over, Protestant England had to defend itself from Roman attack. So England full well knew the danger of Roman Catholic education institutions of education in her country. And yet in this country, the Jesuit institutions of this country have never been opposed. They are regarded as the most prestigious educational institutions in this country. And her Jesuit-trained students occupy the highest levels of our government, our military, and business, including the press. If England had a legitimate worry, what must be the legitimate worry for this country of America? This Protestant land called America. Again, he says, 50 years ago, there were but two colleges in our land for the training of Roman Catholic priests. Of men bound by oath to act in England as the agents of a foreign power. And I will add the word a hostile foreign power, the one great object of which is about to be the dismemberment of our empire and the ruin of our influence in the world. Now there are 29 such schools. And strangest of all, England, who once abolished monasteries and appropriated to national uses the ill-gotten gains of Rome, is now actually endowing Romanism in her empire to the extent of over $1 million of money per annum. The exact amount is £1,052,657 a year. The author now is giving you a history of the continual battles between Protestantism and Roman Catholicism in England, so much so that Protestant England had to abolish the monasteries. And now, even at the time of the writing of this book, Rome has revived, and the government of England is subsidizing the Roman Catholic Church in England by the tune of £1,052,657 a year. Now he continues. Results even more serious have arisen from the dropping on the part of evangelical Christianity, Protestant Christianity, of its distinctive testimony against Romish doctrine and practice. An apostasy has taken place in the Reformed Church of England itself, and multitudes of its members, uninstructed in the true nature and history of the Roman Catholic Church, and ignorant of the prophetic teachings of Scripture about it, have rejoiced in a return to many of the corruptions of doctrine and practice which their forefathers died to abolish. Our Reformed faith is thus endangered, both from without and from within, and it can be defended only by a resolute return to the true witness borne by saints and martyrs of other days. We must learn afresh from divine prophecy God's estimate of the character of the Church of Rome, if we would be but moved afresh to witness for Christ against this great apostasy. As Protestants, as Christians, as free men, as philanthropists, as those who are acquainted with the teachings of history, we deplore the existing state of things. We regard all these changes as a retrograde movement, a movement backwards, of the most dangerous character. And we feel constrained to renew the grand old protest to which the world owes its modern acquisitions of liberty, knowledge, peace, and prosperity. We recognize it as a patent and undeniable fact that the future of our race lies not with papists, but with Protestants. Its leading nations this day are not papal Italy, Spain, and Portugal, but Protestant Germany, England, and America. What has made the difference? The nations that embraced the Protestant Reformation movement of the 16th century have never since ceased to advance in political power, social prosperity, philanthropic enterprise, and general enlightenment, while the nations that refused it and held fast to the corruptions of Rome have as steadily retrograded in all these respects. Quote, "By their fruits ye shall know them," unquote. The present course of lectures, it is intended to arouse fresh attention to the great controversy between the Church of Rome and evangelical churches. In this war, the Roman army stands on the one side and Protestantism in one unbroken phalanx on the other. The regiments of Rome wear but one scarlet uniform, fly but one papal flag, and use in their religious ceremonies but one dead language, Latin. The Protestant army, on the other hand, consists of many divisions, clad in different uniforms, flying different flags, and speaking different languages. But, like the composite hosts of Germany in the struggle with France, they are all the stronger for their voluntary union. They can cordially join in the great struggle. The secondary denominational differences existing between Episcopalians, Presbyterians, and nonconformists are all lost sight of in their common conflict with Rome. And the sole issue is between those who hold to the old gospel of Christ and those who teach another gospel, which is not another. Our subject in these lectures is Romanism and the Reformation from the standpoint of prophecy. That is, we propose to give you not only merely human view of the subject, but the divine view. Not the opinions of the lecturer about it, but the teachings of the prophets and the apostles. The judgment of the only wise God as expressed in his sacred word. In this blessed divine revelation, which sheds its beams on every subject of interest to the people of God. It is a fact that though the canon of Scripture was closed ages before Romanism began to exist, and 15 centuries before the Protestant Reformation, yet it presents the divine judgment as to both. The Bible records the past in its histories and the future in its prophecies, which are simply history written beforehand. It expresses, moreover, moral judgments as to the individuals it describes and the acts which it records. And it similarly expresses moral judgments respecting the individuals and actions which it predicts. It warned the church against the wiles of Rome papal, even from the days of Rome pagan. John, the victim of Nero and Domitian, painted pictures of posterity of the pictures for posterity of the martyrs of the Inquisition and the cruelties of tyrants more merciless than the Caesars. In viewing this question from the standpoint of prophecy, consequently, our object is not merely to trace the fulfillment of sacred prediction in the broad facts of history as a proof of the inspiration of Scripture, though our lectures must, of course, do that, but it is even more to present the divine view of the Roman papal system, to show what infinite reprobation and abhorrence Scripture pours upon it, and what an awful doom it denounces against it. If we know what God thinks of any system, we know what we ought to think of it and how we ought to act toward it. Forewarned is forearmed. Had the youth of the last two or three generations of England been carefully instructed in the Scriptures bearing on this subject, we should not have lived to see our country troubled and in peril of dismemberment through Jesuit intrigues, nor our national church divided against itself to its own imminent danger, and one section of it relapsing into the apostasy from which the Reformation had delivered it. Let me first define distinctly the three terms of our title: Romanism, the Reformation, and prophecy. Let me answer the questions. What is Romanism? What was the Reformation? What is prophecy? Number one, Romanism is apostate Latin Christianity. Not apostate Christianity merely, but apostate Latin Christianity. The Greek church, the Armenian church, and the Coptic church are all apostate in greater or less degrees, and the Protestant church itself has no small measure of apostasy in it, but it is of Romanism or Latin Christianity alone that we now speak, because it is the great and terrible power of evil so largely predicted by the prophet Daniel and by the apostle John. It is the special apostasy which bulks most largely in prophecy, and it is the culmination of Christian apostasy. It includes all whose public worship is conducted in Latin and who own allegiance to the Pope of Rome. Dean Millman's History of the Church of Rome is called The History of Latin Christianity. Archbishop Trench speaks of Gregory the Great as, quote, the last of the Latin fathers and the first in modern sense of the popes, and says he, quote, did more than any other to set the church forward on the new lines on which it must travel, to constitute a Latin Christianity with distinctive features of its own, such as broadly separated from the Greek. Romanism is this Latin Christianity become apostate. Number two, the Reformation was a return to primitive or non-apostate Christianity, accomplished between 3 and 4 centuries ago in this country, in Germany, and some other countries of Europe. One feature of this great movement was the abandonment of the use of Latin in public worship and the translation of the scriptures into living languages so that all the nations might read the word of God in their own tongue and understand for themselves its sacred messages. The names of Luther, Zwingli, Erasmus, Tyndale, Knox, Calvin, Latimer, Ridley, Cranmer, Hooper, and others are associated with this Reformation. Number three, and in the third place, prophecy is the divinely given mirror of the future. Quote, things not seen as yet, unquote, are reflected on its surface and more or less distinctness. They may be partially discerned beforehand and clearly identified when the time of fulfillment comes. Thus, the first advent of Christ was shown, though but in a glass darkly, thousands of years before it took place. And so the tragic episodes of the siege of Jerusalem were presented to the mind of Moses ages before the city was even built. Romanism and the Reformation both lay afar in the distant future when Daniel and John foresaw their history. But their prophetic visions and writings reflect both one and the other with a distinctness and clearness which is the exact equivalent of their magnitude and importance in the history of the church and of the world. Bear in mind these three brief definitions. One, Romanism is apostate Latin Christianity. Number two, the Protestant Reformation was a return to primitive, non-apostate Christianity accomplished 3 centuries ago. Number three, prophecy is the mirror of the future. Let us next inquire, what is this Romanism or Latin Christianity as distinguished from Greek or Protestant or any other form of faith of Christ? As to its doctrines and practices, we will answer this question later on in our course of lectures, quoting from its own acknowledged standards. For the present, we must confine ourselves to a consideration of its history. But before I give you a brief outline of this, I may state that there are three distinct sets of prophecies of the rise, the character, the deeds, and the doom of Romanism. The first is found in the book of Daniel, the second in the epistles of Paul, and the third in the letters of the Apocalypse of John. And no one of these three is complete in itself. It is only by combining their separate features that we obtain the perfect portrait. Just as we cannot derive from one gospel a complete life of Christ, but in order to obtain this, we must take into account the records of the other three. So we cannot from one prophecy gather a correct account of Antichrist. We must add to the particulars given in one those supplied by the other two. Some features are given in all three prophecies, just as the death and resurrection of Christ are given in all four Gospels. Others given only in two, and others are peculiar to one. As might be expected from the position and training of the prophet, who was a statesman and a governor in Babylon, Daniel's foreview presents the political character and relations of Romanism. The Apostle Paul's foreview, on the other hand, gives the ecclesiastical character and relations of this power. And John's prophecies, both in Revelation 13 and Revelation 17, present the combination of both. I will add the words political and religious, church and state. He says the mutual relations of the Latin church and the Roman state. Okay? He uses composite figures, one part of which represents the political aspects of Romanism as a temporal government, and the other, its religious aspects as an ecclesiastical system. In this lecture, we deal with Daniel's political foreview, with his predictions of the great power of evil, which was revealed to him as destined to arise in the Fourth Empire, and which he describes in chapter 7 of his book. Before we consider this prophecy, you must allow me briefly to recall a few well-known historical facts that none can deny or even question. The last 25 centuries of human history, that is, the story of the leading nations of the earth since the days of King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon, has been divided into two chronologically equal parts, each lasting for about 12 and a half centuries. During the first half of this period, four great heathen empires succeeded each other in the rule of the then known world: the Babylonian, Medo-Persian, Grecian, and Roman empires. They lasted from the 8th century before Christ to the 5th century of our era, and ended with the fall of the last emperor of Rome, Romulus Augustulus, in AD 476. During the second half of this period, no one great empire has ever ruled over the whole sphere dominated by these old pagan governments. Power has been more divided, and modern kingdoms have replaced ancient empires. A commonwealth of nations has for the last 1,200 years existed in the territory once governed by old Rome, and no monarch has ever succeeded in subjecting them all to himself. This makes a broad distinction between ancient and modern times, and the dividing line is the fall of the old Roman Empire, the breakup of the last form of ancient civilization, the one which preceded our modern Christian civilization. Rome itself, that great and ancient city, was founded about the beginning of the long period I have named, and has therefore been in existence for nearly 2,600 years, though for many centuries it had been but a local reputation. Gradually it rose to importance, and in the second century before Christ it attained supremacy in the earth. After that, it was for about 500 years the magnificent metropolis of the last and mightiest of the four great empires of antiquity, the seat of its government, the very heart and center of the then known world. Nineveh and Babylon had each in its day been great metropolitan cities of wonderful size, wealth, and influence. But the realms they ruled were small compared to those over which Rome, in its zenith of power, exercised her imperial sway. She was for long ages in the esteem of all civilized nations, as well as in her own, the mistress of the world. Her proud preeminence of position was based on an unequal degree of military strength and power. It was a rule, not of right, but of might, and it subjected the world to itself. Remains still extant, not only in all parts of Europe, but in Africa and Asia, and above all in Rome itself, sufficiently attest to the wide extent of the sway of Rome, the luxury of her princes and people, and the refinements of her civilization. Roman roads, Roman camps, Roman baths, Roman coins, statues, and remains of every kind abound even in our own little isle, speaking of England here, some of which had been examined with interest by most of us. In other words, the citizens of England can literally walk over their land and see the relics of this ancient Roman Empire. They still exist today. They're the subject of tourist travel to England. Now, continuing, he says, Roman laws, Roman literature, and the fundamental relation of the Latin language to the languages of modern Europe afford clearer evidences still of the universal, mighty, and long-enduring influence of the ancient masters of the world. Up to the beginning of the 4th century of our era, Rome was a pagan city, and the emperor was the high priest of its religion. The ruin of its old heathen shrines still adorn the city. The Pantheon, which is now a church dedicated to the Virgin Mary and all the martyrs, was formerly a heathen temple dedicated to Cybele and all the gods of the ancient mythology. But in the 4th century of our era, heathenism fell prostrate before the faith of Christ, which for three centuries, Rome had persecuted and sought to exterminate. The religion of Jesus of Nazareth overthrew the religion of Jupiter, Olympius, and the Emperor Constantine established Christianity as the creed of the world. Rome had become the seat of a Christian bishop before that date, and in the division and decay of the Roman Empire, which soon followed, this bishop, owing to his metropolitan position, became a person of great importance and the head of Latin Christianity. As other rulers passed away, and as the power of Rome waned before the hordes of Gothic and Vandal invaders, the Christian bishopric, sole survival of the old institutions of Rome, raised its head like a rocky reef in the midst of a wild expanse of roaring billows. It remained when all else failed around it. At first, it had itself been a small, weak, new thing under the shadow of a great, mighty, and ancient power. But time brought changes, and gradually it became the stable, strong, and only ancient thing in the midst of the turbulent young Gothic nations into which the fragments of the old Roman dominion slowly crystallized. To these rude and recently evangelized people, the Church of Rome was naturally the mother church, and the Bishop of Rome, the chief of Christian bishops. The tendency of the Latin episcopate, thus enthroned in the old metropolis of the world, in the midst of ignorant, superstitious, and childlike Gothic nations, was to become first a monarchical and then an imperial power. This tendency was deep and enduring. It worked for centuries, till at last it produced that singular, blasphemous usurpation and tyrannical government which we call the papacy. The rise of this power was, like all great growths, gradual and slow. From the middle of the 5th century to the end of the 13th, for between 800 and 900 years, it was steadily waxing greater and greater, rising higher and higher, reaching forth its branches more widely, and making more extravagant claims and pretensions. Time would, of course, fail me to trace the rise of ecclesiastical power in the Middle Ages to the monstrous proportions it assumed in the 13th century. After the conversion of Constantine, when Christianity became the established religion of the Roman world, the church passed rapidly from a state of persecution, poverty, and distress to one of honor, wealth, and ease. And it degenerated as rapidly from its early purity. Covetousness and avarice came in like a flood, and ecclesiastical power became an object of eager ambition, even to ungodly men. The bishop was a wealthy, influential, worldly dignitary instead of a humble Christian pastor. Opulence poured in upon the priesthood, alike from the fears of the affections of their converts, and their intellectual superiority of the barbarian nations had the effect of increasing still more their ascendancy. The time came when they alone retained any semblance of learning, or could prepare a treaty, or write a document, or teach princes to read. By a variety of sordid frauds, they contrived to secure to the church immense wealth and an enormous share of land. But they recognized their own subjection to the secular power and respected mutually each other's independence. Claims to supremacy over other bishops began, however, before long to be advanced by the bishops of Rome. Sometimes on one ground and sometimes on another, but it was long before they were admitted. Papal authority indeed made no great progress beyond the bounds of Italy until the end of the 6th century. At this period, the celebrated Gregory I, a talented, active, and ambitious man, was Bishop of Rome. He stands at the meeting place of ancient and medieval history, and his influence had a marked effect on the growth of Latin Christianity. He exalted his own position very highly in his correspondence and intercourse with other bishops and with the sovereigns of Western Europe, with whom he was in constant communication. Claims that had previously been only occasionally suggested were now systematically passed and urged. He dwelt much on the power conferred on the bishops of Rome in the possession of the keys of the kingdom of heaven, which were committed to Peter and his successors. The Gothic nations were too ignorant to unravel the sophistries of this clever and determined priest, and they permitted him to assume a kind of oversight of their ecclesiastical matters. His successor, Boniface III, carried these pretensions still higher. He was the last of the bishops of Rome and the first of the popes. In his days, the claim to supremacy over all other bishops was not only definitely made, but it was acknowledged by the secular power and confirmed by an imperial edict. The wicked usurper focused to serve his own selfish purposes, conceded to Boniface III in AD 607 the headship over all the churches of Christendom. A pillar is still standing in Rome, which was erected in memory of this important concession. This was a tremendous elevation, the first upward step on the ladder that led the bishops of Rome from the humble pastorate of a local church to the mightiest throne in Europe. But still, all that was claimed or granted was simple episcopacy, though of a universal kind. No thought of a secular government existed at this period. The matter, however, did not stop here. This supreme episcopal jurisdiction led to constant interferences of the Roman bishop in the affairs of the various nations of Christendom and to ever-increasing pretensions to authority in matters secular as well as ecclesiastical, until 500 years later, in 1073, Pope Gregory VII took a great stride in advance and established a theocracy on earth. He was the first who claimed, as the representative of deity, to be above all the kings in the world. This proud and self-exalting man strove and strove successfully not only to emancipate the spiritual power from all control by the state, not only to secure for it absolute independence, but further to subject the secular power of princes to the spiritual power of priests, and thus to establish at Rome in his own person and in the succession of the Roman pontiffs an absolute and supreme ruler of the world. Nor did he pronounce this new and startling doctrine as a theory only. With daring audacity, he excommunicated the German Emperor Henry IV, released his subjects from allegiance to him, and forbade them to obey him as sovereign. And here the author gives us a note. He says, "Wherefore, trusting in the justice and the mercy of God and of his blessed mother, the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, on your authority, that of St. Peter and of St. Paul, the above-named Henry and all his adherents, I excommunicate and bind in the fetters of anathema. On the part of God Almighty and on yours, I instruct him from the government of all Germany and of Italy, I interdict him from the government of all Germany and Italy. I deprive him of all royal power and dignity. I prohibit every Christian from rendering him obedience as king. I absolve all who have sworn or shall swear allegiance to his sovereignty from their oaths." That's a quote by this pope, who tyrannized King Henry IV, excommunicated him from the church, and gave and told all the citizens of his country no more to obey him. This is the arrogance of what started out to be just a bishop among bishops, a local priest. He's now crowning and uncrowning the kings of Europe. Now the author continues, "He actually succeeded in exacting humiliating concessions from the emperor, and yet he subsequently bestowed his kingdom on another. This pope turned the bishopric of Rome into a universal and unlimited monarchy, and the sovereigns of Europe were unable to oppose his unprecedented usurpations. He established also an undisguised and irresistible despotism over the national churches in other lands by enacting that no bishop in the Catholic Church should enter on the exercise of his functions until the Pope had confirmed his election, a law of far-reaching and vast importance by which perhaps more than any other means Rome sustained for centuries her temporal power as well as her ecclesiastical influence. Let me explain. What the author is telling you is that the Pope not only picked the kings of every nation, but he picked all the priests and all the bishops of the Roman Catholic Church, no matter in what land they lived. And these bishops and priests, handpicked by the Pope, all knew, just as did the kings that the Pope picked, that they had to kowtow to the Pope. Because the Pope, if he picked them, he could also unpick them. And the papacy has made a complete history of itself doing just that. Picking and unpicking kings, bishops, and priests. And you know what the bishops and the priests have in common with the kings that the Pope picks? They're all the established governmental superstructure of the papacy. Let me explain it another way. You'll hear in many discussions today that there is a shadow government that rules over the world, that our visible governments that we observe in the news and all their actions, they're being controlled by a shadow government. And many will suggest to you who or what that shadow government would be or is. But history, the earliest history of the Roman Catholic Church, tells us who that shadow government is. It is the priestcraft, the priestly hierarchy of the Roman Catholic Church, the bishops and the priests who oversee the secular governments of every land, and they report to the Pope which kings and which sovereigns are obedient to the Pope and which are not. And the papacy, through its bishops and priests, react however the Pope demands. There is not a single person listening to my voice that should any longer doubt who or what the shadow government is in the world. It's the papacy and his Roman Catholic hierarchy. The graduates of the Jesuit universities that occupy the highest places in our government, whose first loyalty is to the Pope, they all together govern this country by their own fiat. And those who hold political offices only maintain those offices if they remain in the good stead of the popes, the priests, and the bishops of the Roman Catholic Church. Because Rome's incubators, these universities, these Jesuit universities, are constantly cultivating their replacements if they do not obey the priesthood. Now I see our hour is up. I'll put a mark here, and I'll turn it over, and we'll have discussion. We've concluded the first half of page 21 in this book, Romanism and the Reformation from the Standpoint of Prophecy, by Henry Grattan Guinness.